new book releases from Scars Publications. I also have, there are two literary magazines. One's DC and D, you got to hear about the other one. The other one is Dawn of the Dirt magazine. Somebody sent me a story in there, and it was called A Finch in the Window. And I thought, oh my gosh, I happen to have photos of a finch in flight from the Galapagos Island. I'm going to have to pull that one off because it's just the coolest thing. I actually heard a story from someone whom publishes a CC&D magazine. And he said, hi, thanks for letting me know about the new issue out of CC&D, but my house, and he names the island, he is in the Florida Keys. He's like, my house is a total loss. But I plan on buying the September and October issues soon. I'm like, oh my gosh, I had no idea you lived there. I really hope you're okay. And I'm like, wait, as a consolation, I'm working on the December issue, and it's named after the title of your piece.
Mm-hmm.
I hope you like it. He's that's like, cool. Oh, that's cool. Thank you. That makes my day.
Anyway. House destroyed.
Yeah, house is a loss. I have no idea how bad or what. You know, if he's just thinking, but I will buy an issue soon. So apparently things are, you know, I don't know. Normally I share a bunch of my coupons in these issues, but I'm not going to do that with this one. I thought what I would share is there actually happens to be a performance section in the back of this one. And although it's not in this one, I'm going to share it with you anyway. Unless you'd like to be a longer one, I can have...
Your choice in time.
All right, I'm gonna do a bunch of poems. These first ones are actually, this one also happens to actually appear in Faramine's 2015 to 2017 poems, so I might as well show that book off to you, because I haven't had two of them that are up right now, but I might as well show off the book that it's actually for. That one's in a regular poems book, and this one is called Origin, from the Macro to the Micro. The thought of it has always gone through our heads. Where did we come from? How did this all begin? When we think of when our mom held us when we were little, we wonder, there has to be something more. Something bigger, something more. This was ingrained into our American heads. We look up to the stars, and yes, some did that to understand the greatness of not only our world, but of the entire cosmos. Scientists figured out the laws of physics on the macro. This is what their heaven was, and this is where everything works. I look at the gold wedding band and engagement ring on my hand and think that the gold, the titanium, the elements that we value so much here on planet Earth because they are so rare, but then we think of astronomy. We know that when the universe was formed, the only elements first rather small, hydrogen, maybe helium. It was only when these energetic atoms gained mass that they clumped together and formed our first stars. Elements from carbon to iron are produced in the cores of stars in high-temp fusion reactions there. But what about those heavy rare elements we ascribe so much value to? Well, scientists research, that's what they do, and they discover that collisions of neutron stars in our cosmos have the energy to produce elements heavier than iron. An astronomer named Berger even said that they do it efficiently enough that they can account for all of the gold that's been produced in the universe.
Wow.
You might think that the death of the star is a nasty thing, and it is, but the science that makes what we love. Wow, I'm actually quoting astronomers, and this actually works out so beautifully like that. But that is all, you know, micro, these little things. And I'm thinking locally here with the metal on my hands, the hematite I wear, like what Mars rovers found. I look at the mountains and canyons where the ice age melts. I hear the babbling brook, or I see a flower in bloom. And when I look around, I think that these work too. But now put it all on a celestial scale to observe a close encounter between a small galaxy and the outer edge of a larger galaxy, sending it spinning to form arms of a new spiral galaxy, not much unlike our own Milky Way. So if we think of it, these elements in our bodies are formed by the stars. So make them like macro micro, since we're all made of stardust. Remember, the static in your television is not unlike the cosmic radiation that scientists found when studying the universe when they accidentally discovered the noise from the Big Bang.
Mm.
Wow, it almost makes me starry-eyed to think of what astronomical theoretical theoreticians might say, and they might actually come up with next, since a scientist's job is to postulate, theorize, then work to prove or disprove.
When did they first hear the noise?
How beautiful is that, though? I mean, just coming up with this stuff. Because once you get the right equations, micro or macro, this is when everything truly works.
When did they first hear the bang?
Well, they actually were trying to, they had a satellite and they were trying to, and they're like, we're getting a lot of like radiation or it's static. And we're like, are there, did pigeons poop on the thing? And so they're checking to clean it.
Right.
And they're like, there's nothing. And they sent it to another department where they're like, oh, we think this is the background radiation from the Big Bang.
Appreciate it.
You know, and this is what, you know, that's amazing.
It is.
It's really amazing. This is another poem that appears in Fair Memes 2015 and 2017 poems, because there's all sorts of subjects that are covered in it. And this one is called Violence and Peace. Violence and Peace both work.
Whoa,
you
me.
Didn't think so.
Not for me.
Not people like him, but you know, sometimes it can work. Because how can, if you get a pull and tug in order to make something balance, that's going to, well, I'll shush. I'll say this poem and leave it at that. It's called Violence and Peace. We look up to the stars and we reach out and pray. In ancient times, people looked up to the stars and saw heaven. They then looked up to those stars and created gods etched to battle throughout the ages in their constellations. Throughout time, the one thing I've discovered is that wherever we see peace and tranquility, where everything works and falls into place, you can see the bad there too, almost like you can't have one without the other. I imagine if you ever got into heaven, it would probably be missing all the vices that we love. Even though I don't gamble, I'm sure it wouldn't be allowed there. And I couldn't get a good German Riesling wine or even a good Weissbier. What a chip. Oh, the afterlife is so boring.
What do you know?
I like to sing, but if I have to sing Kumbaya one more time. And if there's a poetry open mic in heaven, I'm sure all you'd hear is Psalms of David over and over, since that's the only poetry in the Bible.
Yeah.
In other words, what works for some might not work for others. Because when we look at the stars, find peace, admire the tranquility of stars in the night sky, we don't realize that these stars are actually evil, always exploding giants.
Right.
What we see are the post-explosion nebula catastrophes with temperatures hotter than we can even imagine. We look up what we can't reach, and we see peace and tranquility with everything working together. But if we look closer, we can see the violence there too. And if we can see how perfectly the bad stuff fits in there, it fits in there just as well. It is possible on a celestial scale to help. If the stars are beautiful, yeah, but don't get too close.
Exactly.
Yeah, but don't get too close. Yeah. It ain't quite right sometimes.
They're all dead. They're all dead.
I'm not even going to talk about when they think they've seen something from like light from 14 billion years
That's
old,
right.
And they're like, this is a star, that like one of the first stars in existence.
Yep.
And we're only seeing the light now. It's taken that long to get to it.
Isn't that extraordinary?
But now I'm going to go on about performance art stuff, because it's related to Halloween stuff.
Sure.
This was stuff done at a show at the Baha'i Center in 2016. And I don't even think, with our host here knowing the Baha'i Center, I don't even think he was there to hear these.
Wow.
So I'll get to share with you now. This first one is called Masquerade. You asked me to the masquerade and I willingly complied, but I'm tired of wearing this dress, for the feathers in the costume won't stop licking my face, and you cannot see the tears falling behind my mask. when you see the price they pay, I'm sure you'll come and join the masquerade, you say. But the price is too high, for I don't want to wear a mask with you, and I only would hope that I wouldn't have to. This one is actually something that is appropriate for Halloween, because when I had done a poem for the Element and Periodic Table, I dressed up as Marie Curie for Halloween one year for her wedding day, because she wore a black dress to her wedding, which is discussed in this poem. This is a poem from Periodic Table poetry. It's called Curium. Searching through storage for my wedding clothes, I ignored my white wedding dress and reached for a wedding veil. It might not be true, my Halloween costume, but I had to wear something to show that my black dress was actually a wedding dress. I'll carry a small bunch of white flowers and make them my otherwise goth wedding look complete. But still, I'd have to explain that my Halloween costume was an interpretation of Marie Curie on her wedding day. And okay, maybe it wasn't goth, but a diligent work ethic that caused Marie Curie on her own wedding day to wear a black dress she wore so that she would be able to wear that same black dress later on for her own work. And yeah, when she worked, she really got messy with her radioactive elements, ergo the black dress, I suppose. She studied different levels of radioactivity in different elements. She learned what was causing the radiation. She even coined the phrase radioactivity when she discovered the two radioactive elements, radium and polonium. But looking back on her life, maybe wearing the black dress was appropriate, because she soared in all schooling that she could legally take. At that time, she couldn't enroll in higher education because she was female. So she eventually had to go to underground learning for higher education in makeshift classrooms that lasted only a few days before the government raid would cause the schooling to have to move again. She then left her Poland for Paris, and she was able to go to school, but still penniless and hungry. But after her second degree, she then met Pierre, who worked with her, even after their marriage, when they gave each other bicycles as wedding gifts.
Wow.
That's so cute. I know, I'm going on and on about Marie Curie for my Halloween costume. But there's even an element named after her that she didn't even discover. But curium is actually one of the most radioactive elements, and curium is now used to help scientists learn and discover, much the way Marie Curie did. Curium helps people to help power artificial pacemakers, but it's even used in alpha particle X-ray spectrometers that are installed on lunar and Mars rovers like the Sojourner or the Spirit and Odd Opportunity rovers. It's even used on the spacecraft to probe the surface of a comet. So curium is dangerous, but it helps us learn, which makes curium here a bit, give us a bit of a glow to it, I think, because both being a goth girl and loving to dive into my work is really making me take a shine to this black wedding dress thing. And when I got the idea from a woman who struggled to succeed in her work and in science, it shows me how science fits perfectly with the entire world as well.
Yeah,
I can give people Halloween poems.
Jim, try that.
I'll give you a couple Halloween poems.
Yeah.
This one's called This Halloween. It's coming up. This Halloween. This Halloween, I got a costume together. I wore a black pageboy wig, a vinyl dress, and matching vinyl boots. It was strange for me. I'm not such an outgoing person. And every time I was left alone in a bar, someone would hit on me, usually someone ugly. But I didn't tell them to leave me alone. I gave them a fake name,
yeah.
A fake number.
Yep.
And looking back, what made the difference was not wearing the revealing clothes, but wearing a wig, changing my identity. And it's not like I'd do that again. I must admit, I really like being someone else for just a little while.
It's good. Absolutely right.
This one is called This Halloween Again. I have no plans for the holiday this year. No parties. Well, none that I'm going to. I am dressing up for Halloween, though, in something that almost doesn't look like a costume. I want to be a Scotsman for Halloween. Not because I'm Scottish. I'm not. Not because I'm male. I'm not. In my costume, people probably won't even think I'm dressed up for Halloween. But I'll know. I never did anything with you for Halloween. Well, when it was Halloween a year or two ago, I put on a wig and dressed up and I picked you up from the airport. It's funny how easy it is to remember little stories like that. You were dressed up as a cartoon character for Halloween last year. I never got to see you in that outfit. I always thought I would get to see it another time. I didn't think you'd be gone before the next Halloween rolled around. I thought you'd always be around. You always were, you know. When I needed to talk to you, I called, or else you called me instead. It was almost like I had a little brother there who was always willing to listen to me, who was always wanting to put up with me. My question is to you, were you always willing to put up with me? Did you think that things would end this way? Just so you know, wherever you are, that sometimes I am thinking about you. And because I know the holidays aren't the same without you. I never thought about dressing up for Halloween or about Scotland or even other countries, but you, well, you were Scottish through and through, and you wanted a kilt, and you wanted the world to know that you were Scottish. I always thought you'd be around. I thought, even when you aggravated me, that you would always be there for me. Now I have to be there for myself. I wonder how lonely people get when they lose someone they were close to. Do they feel like a piece of them is missing too?
Yeah.
Well, I do. And I figure someone has to be a Scotsman for Halloween. Even this year, it only has to be me.
Good mom. Good.
And I've got one more from this one, and I think this is a fun one. He's like, I don't know. This one's called Salesman.
Okay.
The doorbell rang. Who could be stopping by at this hour, I thought. But I put my work down and I walked to the door. A man in a plaid suit stood there in the doorway. He had a worn book in his hand. His business suit seemed like a costume that almost looked comical for the sad clown. I almost expected to see a swirling bow tie with water squirting out of his fake flower in his pocket, but he flashed me a tired, business-like smile. It almost seemed genuine. As he rambled on and on about, well, I don't really even know what he said. I don't even know what he wanted. What is he selling? I thought, and my head became dizzy with his confusing words. Try to be nice to the strange man. He knocked on your door and you felt obliged to greet him. So, as I was standing there, it all seemed like nonsense. You listened to his words and you tried to make sense of his nouns and his verbs. And when he heard fractions, he mentioned a call to action. I didn't like what I heard, but I tried to listen. I wanted to listen. But after a while, I just had to hold on to the door frame. I had to keep myself steady while this man's thoughts tried to knock me down. I finally stopped him. What are you trying to sell me? What are you trying to do? I asked. And the man looked at me and said, I'm trying to sell you an ideology. I'm trying to poison your mind. I slammed the door in his face. Alone, I let go of the door frame. I fell down.
Aww.
That was the end of the one from the show.
Yeah.
And that is all in A Finch in the Window.
Yeah.
And those ones from that show are not in this book. But they are performance art pieces.
How do you get them published? What do you use?
Oh, long time ago I was looking at things and I found myself, when I was very young, being rejected from places, and then people would send me magazines, and I noticed that all of the editors who were rejecting me were editors of those magazines.
Right.
And I thought, So a long, long time ago, I started up Scars Publications.
Right.
But Scars Publications.
Physically, how do you get them printed?
Well, back in the day, I would hand print them and sell them manually.
Yeah.
But I've learned over time that I was using Lulu Press to actually send them out. But then I found an Amazon affiliate printer, so that because I have friends that actually, like, I guess colleagues, I should say, people that are in the UK and in Europe who submit stuff, and I feel bad about them having to spend $20 to get something from a US printer. So I have them sold through an Amazon printer. And if anybody wants to know anything about it, you can always go to scars.tv, and for down the dirt, scars.tv/dirt. Things have little barcodes on them, and not only barcodes, but QR codes. They can scan
two it. QR codes.
Now, this QR code is actually just for down the dirt, so it'll actually take you to the website for down the dirt magazine.
Right.
And this one, which says the name of Inch in the Window, that'll take you to the printer page, so you can order the book directly from the printer there.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.